So good evening, Ananda. So today I will be just giving you an introduction to forensic psychology. So what I thought is today, first of all, I will be introducing the concept of first of all forensics, followed by the areas which we deal in forensic psychology, and later on we will be having question answer session. So before starting the psychology or forensic psychology, I just want to give an insight. First of all, about crime. So what is basically crime? Because most of the participants, I hope they are from the pure psychology background, and because of that, I would like to share the concept when it comes to the basic principles what we learn in basic criminology. So first of all, what is crime? So when you talk about crime, we can say that there are a lot of definitions given by different criminologists when it comes to crime. So we can say, we can take a very simple definition when it comes to, it is an unlawful act. So basically crime means it is an unlawful act. It can be against the person. So basically the crime, especially according to the definitions, the crime is something against the person, or it can be against the state also. So there are different ways we define crime. There are different ways of explaining crime. So, and there are different ways of understanding crime. So basically we can say crime is an unlawful act, so committed by a person. So generally we call him as a criminal. So I remember when I started my career as a forensic faculty, And before that, when I was a trainee in the Gujarat Forensic Science University, a lot of people even ask, common people ask, why we need to give importance for criminals, or why we need to study about criminals. So criminals are also human beings. They are also like us. So situations, certain situations made them a criminal. Or we can say there are a lot of genetic reasons when it comes to certain psychopathic, or when it comes to sociopathic, okay, there are certain nurture and nature factors are there which we discuss in basic psychology. So it is very important that we should be in a position to rehabilitate and reintegrate the criminals. So mostly according to the National Crime Records Bureau, so there is a organization called as National Crime Records Bureau in India, where they give a statistical analysis of the data and entire data of the crimes which has happened in the entire India, that is year by year. So according to NCRB, we can say that 90% of the cases, or 95% of the cases in India, most of the offenders are situational offenders, just because of a particular situation, as also because of their impulsive behavior, or because of their aggressive behavior, they became a criminal. So with the help of psychology, it is possible for us to rehabilitate and to reintegrate the people, or we can reform the basic people, that is basically the criminal. It is possible for us to rehabilitate as well as reintegrate and as well as reform the criminals with the help of psychology. So this is what we deal in forensic psychology. So this is just a certain information about what happened now, especially certain according to the crimes in India last year, 2019. So they say that there was a rise in certain criminal activities like murder, abduction, rape, etc., etc. in India. So in India, India is one of the countries where the crimes are increasing day by day. So right now it has become the cyberspace, where we call about the cyber crimes. Or basically we say about a lot of crimes are happening in the cyberspace, which is basically called as the cyber crimes. And this is one of the, another from the Global Peace Index, what they say is that the India is considered to be the most fourth dangerous country for women travelers. So even if we say about Indian culture, so the crimes are increasing day by day. So it is a high time to address these crimes in a very scientific approach. With the use of scientific techniques, we should approach and we should resolve the crime with the help of scientific aids, that is with the help of forensic science. So before going to the forensic, as I told you, you should understand what are crimes, or what are the stages of crime. So the first thing is that if a crime should happen, the first thing is that there should be an intention. First of all, intention to commit a crime. So in legal term, it is called as mens rea. So intention means the mens rea. The person is having the intention to commit a crime. That is the first thing. The second thing is that person should have the preparation. So for example, if I need to kill someone, if I need to murder someone, so I need to prepare something. I need to get some knife, or I need to get some kind of strangulation materials, or I need to procure a gun. So that is a particular where we prepare for something. That is preparation. And last one is attempt. So we attempt that particular. So after the, we are having an intention, so that's something called as mens rea. Then after, so we are having intention to kill someone, so we do have the mens rea. Then the preparation, so we prepare for that. So how we prepare for that? As I told you, we prepare a lot of weapons, no? And we try to do that. And we try to execute it. The last one is attempt. So these are the basic three stages of crime. And excluding the intention, even in the, during the preparation time or even the attempt time, the person can be arrested by the police. And he can be put behind the bars. Okay? So that is just the basic outlook. I just want to give you just a basic information about crime. So today we are going to discuss about forensic psychology, or my duty is to introduce forensic psychology to you. So before going, the term forensic science. So this is the one of the fascinating term for everyone. So what is forensic? So I would say that, so I started my career as an assistant professor in the year 2014. So it has been nearly 6 years. So I remember people asking, what is this? So we are having different streams, especially when it comes to forensics. So I hope last day we were actually, you had a session with one of the scientific officers from the FSF. I hope he might have introduced you the concept of forensic science itself. So the concept of forensic, or the term forensic, derived from a Latin term called as forensis, which means a forum. That means during the Roman period, that is Roman Empire time. So in public places, so generally in the public places, we were having a raised platforms, so to conduct debates or to hear certain people's cases, if they are having any problems, if their two neighbors, if they are having any problems. So they used to settle it in the public places, like market, etc. Okay, there are, so in the public places, there will be certain raised platforms where they conduct debates and they conduct certain hearings with respect to certain cases. So that is the basic meaning of the term forensics. So what I would say is that, when a crime happens in any area, for example, if a crime is happening in a if a crime is happening in a corporate, or if a particular crime is happening in a auditory frame, so basically you can say it is called as forensic auditing, or basically you can say that forensic auditing. So if you are some manipulations you are doing in a account in an accounting area, so wherever the crime happens, that becomes a forensic. So becomes forensics, where we can apply the concept of forensics over there. So in forensic psychology, so basically when you talk about forensic psychology, it's a huge perspective. It's a very broad perspective. So people generally say it is just, so especially in India, when you start talking about forensic psychology, the first thing comes to the basic thing which comes to a person's mind is, okay, polygraph. Then something called as narco analysis. Or people have heard about something called as brain fingerprinting. That is the only thing. No, it is much more than that. So that's the thing which we are going to discuss over here. So forensic science is basically application of fundamental sciences in the court of law. It is just a very basic definition. It is not the, so basically we are having other definitions, standard definitions out there with respect to forensic science. So just make you understand, it is just the application of the sciences, that the fundamental sciences in the court of law. For example, I can give you an example. So I hope most of the people are from psychology. So when we apply the concept of memory, okay, so I hope you have studied the concept of memory in the general psychology, okay, in the first year when you go to any universities or colleges, there will be a paper on general psychology. In general psychology, we study a concept of memory. About sensory memory, short-term memory, long-term memory. We study about Atkinson-Shiffrin model. Then we study about different type of long-term memory like semantic memory, episodic memory. So that particular memory concept is having an application for forensic science, where we apply in eyewitness testimony. So what forensic science is, we are applying the fundamental principles in the criminal investigation or in the criminal justice system. It can be the for the police investigation or the investigation for the normal criminal investigation, or it can be for the trial purposes, especially in the court of law, and even for the prison also, especially when it comes to the making a rehabilitation model, or when it comes to the rehabilitation of the offenders and the reformation of the offenders for that matter. So this is how we can apply the fundamentals, whatever we have learned in psychology. So right now I'm talking on with respect to psychology. So there are, apart from the psychology, we are having different areas in forensic science, like forensic physics is there, chemistry is there, toxicology is there, ballistics is there. So whatever area you take, whatever domain you take, the basic thing is that you apply the fundamental concept what you have learned in the criminal justice system. That's all. That is very simple. So generally, as I told you, when I started my career, people are having, so that is a basic doubt which everyone is having. So what is the basic, how the forensic psychology or criminal psychology, what is forensic psychology, what is criminal psychology, how it is different from criminology? So all these are the areas where the people are having the confusion. So these are the basic areas. Okay, these are the basic disciplines. Okay, so criminology, criminal psychology, forensic psychology, investigative psychology. So that is one of the new branch. Okay, this is one of the new branch which is called as investigative psychology. So what exactly is this? How it is different? Because in entire thing, the common thing is a crime. In all these things, the common thing is a crime. And we are studying about crime. So generally people say, yes, so criminology. So when it comes to criminology, so basic difference is that criminology, basically we study about the social perspectives or a social aspects of crime. That is a basic thing when it comes to criminology. So people ask whether we study psychology. Yes, as a paper. Just as a paper, we study about the psychological theories or psychological perspectives. But we never teach them, especially in psychology, we are having something called as construct test. We are having different type of psychological tests are there. We never do that in criminology. So what the criminology is basically is this. So in criminology, so it is just the basic, so all these are the very basic informations with respect to criminology. As I told you, all the four areas are highly broad areas. They are very broad areas. They are very much specialized area. So it's just the basic understanding I'm trying to give you with respect to the criminology. So in criminology, we just study the nature and crime of the nature of crime and criminals. So what is the type of crimes the person has committed, or depending upon the century. So depending upon the different. So if you compare 90s with 2020, so there are a lot of there was a lot of trend happened. There are a lot of changes happened in the commission of the crime itself. As I told you, right now most of the crimes happen in cyberspace, but in 90s it was not like that. So what are the trends, or what are the trends that was in the crime? Second thing is that the origin of criminal law. So here we also discuss about the origin of criminal law. We study about the criminal laws like IPC, CRPC, Indian Evidence Act, all those kind of things, and other special and local laws. Then the causes of crime. The theology of crime means what are the causes. So here basically we study about what are the social aspects, what are the sociological causes, or we can say what are the psychological causes, even genetics for that matter. There are a lot of biological theories with respect to crime. So we study that. And how the society, the last one is how the society reacts to crime. So when it comes to India, as I told you in the beginning, in India, the crimes are increasing day by day or year by year. What is the reason? First of all, we, as especially as an Indian, or even when it comes to US also, in US also, it's one of the country where the crimes are increasing day by day. So recently you have seen what happened to George Floyd. So in that case, what is happening? The America is burning. So the crimes are everywhere. So how to compromise, how to address that, how to address crime in a scientific approach, in a scientific way. So that's what we study in criminology, especially with respect to the sociological aspects, the help of the social aspects that we do, or that we, that are the basic that are the basic concepts which we learn in criminology. But here, as I told you, we do study about psychological concepts, but not in depth. That is one of the things. Okay, so if you want to study more about psychological factors, then you need to address or you need to study or you have to go for forensic psychology. Okay. Then another area is criminal psychology. So this is the one of the area where the people are having a confusion between forensics and criminal psychology. See, forensic psychology is whenever you apply the concept in court of law, it becomes forensics. As I told you, when you apply something in court of law, in the beginning also I told you, in the introduction session I told you, that is when you apply the fundamental concept or fundamental principle, whatever you have learned in the fundamental sciences, in the criminal investigation or in the purpose of the trial in the court of law, it becomes forensics. Then what is the basic difference in criminal psychology and forensic psychology? So criminal psychology, basically in India we don't have much people called as criminal psychologists. Okay, so in abroad and all, especially there is a unit especially in called as in FBI, there is something called as behavioral science unit. Okay, so behavioral science unit is a unit of FBI. So your FBI itself is having different units are there. One of the unit is called as behavioral science unit. Over there, they are having a group of forensic psychologists are there. Then their police officers are there. Then criminal psychologists are there. Forensic psychologists are there. So it's a group of people. Crime scene investigators are there for the matter. For example, when it comes to behavioral science unit, they are the people those who do the criminal profiling. You might have heard about criminal profiling. So that is done by the behavioral science unit of FBI. So here, these are the four rules of a criminal psychologist. First one is clinical. That is, if a person has committed a crime, okay, just imagine abroad, a person has committed a crime. The first thing is that the person who has undergone the criminal activity will be assessed with the help of psychological tools. And second thing is that, if a person has committed a crime out of his insanity, there's something called as insanity defense or insanity plea, basically what we say. So if a person has committed a crime out of insanity, out of this or her insanity, so the first thing is that criminal psychologist will assess the person whether the person has committed a crime because of his insanity, because of his or her insanity. That is the first thing. First of all, the clinical perspective. First of all, the psychologists, there are trained licensed psychologists are there abroad, which is called, they are called as criminal psychologists, where they assess that with the help of the psychological tools. The second thing is an experimental. As I told you in the beginning, there is something called as eyewitness testimony. So the research study shows that the eyewitness testimonies are wrong. Okay, in most of the cases, the eyewitness testimonies are wrong. So there are a huge database with respect to the reliability and validation of eyewitness testimony, where we are also using the forensic statistics, where we use the probability basis, or basically we use the probability statistics to explain about how can the eyewitness be reliable, how it can be taken as a reliable information. So research study shows that in most of the cases, eyewitness testimony leads to wrongful convictions. And there is something called as Innocence Project. If you are interested in that, you can Google what is Innocence Project. You can get to know about what is National Registry of Exonerations. So there are a lot of areas. There are a lot of so basically, when it comes to Innocence Project, it is just an NGO. It is just an NGO. Okay. So basically, which is helping the people, those who are wrongly confined inside the prison. So Innocence Project. So what the Innocence Project is that it says that 75% of the wrongful conviction is because of the faulty eyewitness testimony. Because of the faulty eyewitness testimony, especially in abroad, especially in America. This is a thing which I am talking about America. In 75% of the cases, that is in 75% of the in wrongful conviction, that is basically when you take the wrongful conviction, in 75% of the cases, it's because of the faulty eyewitness testimony. So here the criminal psychologist also will check the reliability of an eyewitness information. So if an eyewitness is giving an information, so it is a duty of the criminal psychologist to check the authenticity. The third one is actuarial. So here we apply the statistics, as I told you in the beginning. So statistics is also having a greater importance when it comes to the crime. So basically in forensic statistics, we say about value of evidence. And we so basically, it's a little advanced statistics, okay? So where we introduce the concept of statistics, or we apply the concept of statistics in criminal investigation. And the last one is advisory. So they are also act as an advisory for the police officers, attorneys, etc. in abroad. So these are the basic four roles of a criminal psychologist. But in India, we don't have such criminal psychologists. So we do have clinical psychologists. We do have rehabilitation psychologists. We do have counseling psychologists. So generally in India, what basically we do is that we are having NIMHANS in Bangalore. So there is a specialized forensic psychiatry what is there. That is, a person who has completed MD in psychiatry will specialize in forensic area. We do have forensic psychiatry in NIMHANS. So basically, I'm having a lot of friends over there. So generally, we discuss a lot of cases with respect to forensic psychiatries and other things. So forensic psychiatry is there. Forensic psychology is also there. But it is in a very germinating stage, especially in India. Okay, so these are the basic four roles of a criminal psychologist. Then forensic psychology. So this is the one of the thing. Again, as I told you, so I hope I have cleared what is criminology. So where we discuss the sociological perspectives of a crime, then criminal psychology, where we discuss the four roles like the clinical, experimental, actuarial and advisory, and the forensic psychology. So this is the real application what is happening in investigation, or we can say this is one of the applied area where the psychology is getting applied in the criminal investigation or for the purpose of trial, especially in the court of law. So generally the forensic psychology is divided into five disciplines or five sub disciplines. So we need to address all these five things. So when you talk about forensic psychology earlier, before this session, it was just a polygraph for you, or it was just something to do with narco analysis. No, as I told you in the beginning, it is a very broad area where forensic psychology itself can be divided into five main areas. So one is police psychology. So what exactly is police psychology? So especially all these concepts are with respect to the abroad concepts. Okay, all the concept, all the principle, what I'm trying to say you, or what I'm trying to convey to you, is purely based upon the FBI models or the American or we can say it's the abroad models. Okay, so the first thing is police psychology. So what the police psychology is, or who are police psychologists? First of all, the police psychologists are the people, they when the during the recruitment time, okay, in abroad and all, they perform FFD. It is called as so I hope I don't know how many of you heard about that. Is something called as FFD. That is something called as that is basically the duty evaluation, fitness for duty evaluation. Okay, they perform the fitness for duty evaluation. That is, while recruiting the officers over in abroad, they will check whether a particular officer, a particular candidate is fit to become a police officer. The first thing is that they will be recruited based upon the psychological test by the police psychologist. Second thing is that there are a lot of special training courses are there for especially for America and all. You might have seen in movies also, SWAT. It's something called as the Special Weapon and Tactics Team. Then we are having something called as TAT. It's something called as Tactical Response Team. And we are having something called as HNT is there, Hostage Negotiation Team. So when it comes to all these different tactical teams, so the police psychologists are the people who gives them the training, psychological training. Or when it comes to any encounters, okay, after the encounters, so the certain police officers might having certain kind of trauma. So they will go under, they might go under certain depression and all. So it is a duty of a police psychologist to give training for them and give proper counseling as well as psychotherapy for the officers itself, those who are working in this particular team. And there is something called a psychological autopsy. So that is, psychological autopsy doesn't mean that you are opening the brain and doing some kind of analysis. No, that is especially when it comes to the suicide cases, or when it comes to certain kind of accident cases. Okay, generally the psychological autopsy is basically used in the suicide cases, basically. So they take the information from their parents, relatives, friends, and they will look into what is the probability that this particular person commit a crime or the particular person commit a suicide. This is what is something called a psychological autopsy. Then there's something called a detection of deception. So what we generally discuss about polygraph. So that is basically something called as, so a lot of people used to take the term of lie detection. So actually it is not lie detector. Okay, first of all, that is one other thing which you need to take out from your mind. It is not lie detection. Okay, it is when the polygraph never detect lie. Okay, the polygraph never detect lie. It detects certain physiological arousals. So when a question is asked to you, it detects if you are lying, it will detect certain physiological arousals. So basically that's why it's called as biofeedback. So the polygraph is one of the biofeedback machine which detects the biofeedback, that is basically the physiological arousal once you lie. That's the thing. So the police psychologist also deals with the detection of deception with the help of polygraph and other forensic psychological techniques. This is what about police psychology. Second thing is legal psychology. So legal psychology is a combination of both psychology and law, especially in abroad, as I told you, the eyewitness testimony. So here also eyewitness testimony is one of the most important things. So it is a duty of the legal psychologist to analyze the validity and reliability of the eyewitness information. How reliable the information is with respect to the eyewitness. Second thing is that the family issues. When it comes to IPV, it is something called as intimate partner violences. So when it comes to intimate partner violences, it's the duty of the legal psychologist to give a proper understanding about the IPV and give the report in the court of law. Third one is insanity. Again, the insanity defense, as I told you. So there we are having in the criminal psychologies, we have discussed about one of the role. Is one of the role of a criminal psychologist. So when it comes to legal psychology, so criminal psychologist along with a legal psychologist will sit together and they will discuss about the insanity cases or when it comes to the insanity defenses. Okay, so it is purely based upon McNaughton rule. So in abroad they take a particular rule, there is something called as McNaughton rule. So generally what they used to do is they will be taken to they will be having specialized institutions for keeping such people, especially if a person has committed a crime out of his insanity, out of her insanity. So they will be, will be kept at they will be segregated and they will be given the treatment accordingly. Third one is the correctional psychology. So correctional psychology, it is basically applied in prisons. So basically in the correctional institutions, that is basically we called as prisons. So first one is the offender management. So when it comes to prison, we are having a lot of people. That is lot of offenders, lot of criminals. They have committed different sort of crimes. They can be murder, rape, dacoity, robbery. So n number of things. There can be terrorists also. So Naxalites might be there. So there are different forms of criminals might be there. So first of all, how to manage each and everyone. How to sort them, how to properly accommodate them in certain, so basically that is totally with respect to the penology, something called as penology. So that's purely based upon the penology. So first one is the role of a correctional psychologist is offender management. Second thing is that how to reduce the recidivism. So when it comes to any personalization or when it comes to any correctional administration or when it comes to any correctional organization, so what we generally call as prison. The first thing is that there are three main objectives of any personalization. First one is the retention, rehabilitation, and reintegration. So basically we can say reformation also. So basically the three arts of the personalization is reformation, rehabilitation, and reintegration. So first of all, we need to reform the person, we need to rehabilitate the person, and later after the tenure of his after the tenure is done or completed in the prison, he has to be reintegrated to society. So these are the three main arts of any correctional institution. That is basically the reformation, rehabilitation, and reintegration. So the correctional psychologist will help any offender to achieve these three arts. That is the reformation, rehabilitation, and reintegration. So first of all, the rehabilitation, how we can reform the person. So we are having a variety of, especially in abroad, we are having a variety of group therapies. So we are having the one-to-one individual therapies are there, psychotherapies are there, where we can use it, where we can apply it, and we can reform the person. Second thing is that that is basically how we can rehabilitate. So we can help them to achieve certain skills. That is, especially in India, what generally we do is that we will be having a variety of skill set jobs will be there inside the prison, where some of the prisons will be trained, especially there is something called as open air prisons are there, where we train them to how to become a good how to become a good farmer, or they will be trained how to how to continue their life without committing any sort of crime as a cattle rearer. So they will teach how to take care of cattle. Then when it comes to the central prisons, we are having the boot making is there, then craft making is there. So there are a different type of activities that is happening in the prison. So once you go and visit a prison, you will understand what. So basically in certain especially in Kerala and all, we are having bakeries are there. So bakeries are there, then we, with the help of offenders in each and every central prisons, are having their own stalls are there, where they just like our bakeries, just like our they are having hotels also. Basically certain states, especially in Telangana, they are having the hotels are also there, small shops, hotels are there, canteens are there, where it is run by the offenders basically. So these are the certain activities which is basically done inside the prison, where the prison officers or the prison institution help them to. So after their completion of their sentence in the court of law, in the prison, so once they go out, or once they come out of the prison, so without going back to the criminal, preventing them from all these crimes, so the prison institution itself is helping them to become a good citizens. That is something called as rehabilitation. And third one is reintegration. So reintegration is something that is returning to the society, whether we accept the criminal or not. That is when it comes to the reintegration. For example, whether we give a job to a person. So if you understand, if a person is saying that, okay, I've served the prison for 2 years for a particular crime, and the person is approaching you after his sentence, the person is approaching you whether you will be in a position to give him the job. So what happens in India is that is one of the research finding also says that this is one of the problems when it comes to society. This is why the crimes are increasing. So generally there are a lot of countries, especially the Scandinavian countries are there. So in Scandinavian countries, and there are certain countries like Netherlands. So one of the countries which I need to say, where the crimes are more or less 0%. You won't believe that. More or less, zero. Most of the Scandinavian countries, very, very less. The crimes are very less. Why? Because they accept the criminal, they accept the criminal, not the crime. They hate the crime, but not the criminal. That is the thing. Because after the sentence is done, so the society will accept them as a normal person. But in India, or even in the US also for that matter. So once a person has come out from the prison, he won't get a proper job. He won't get a good job. So why? Because we are having that particular stigma. Okay, he's a criminal. He has to be kept aside, or he has to be kept apart from the society. And we are normal people. So that is one of the stigma that is in the society. That has to be addressed. So that will be addressed. That has to be addressed by society itself. So these are the three main principles of a correctional psychology. And one more important thing is that it is not at all dealing with offenders. It also deals with the prison officers itself. So there will be a lot of stress, or there will be a lot of psychological problems faced by the prison officers itself. So it is a duty of the correctional psychologist to give them proper psychological management. That is basically one of the examples which I can give you is the stress management, which can be the stress management training can be provided to the prison officers, or increasing the resilience. That is one of the other thing which we can be used. So basically there are a lot of ways where we can increase the resilience of such prison officers. Okay, that is another objective of having a professional psychologist inside the prison. And these three areas, so basically these three areas of prison, sorry, the police psychology, the legal psychology and correctional psychology is considered to be the applied area. And other two things are there, which is something called the psychology of crime and delinquency and the victimology and victim assistance. So here, psychology of crime and delinquency means that is something to do with the juveniles, juvenile offenders. So when it comes to juvenile offenders, so why the person, why a juvenile is committing a crime at the younger age, why the person is committing crime? So there are a lot of research going on why a juvenile is becoming a crime, a criminal. So there are, as I told you, there are a lot of reasons for that. There are, we can have a biopsychosocial model for that. Yes, there are a lot of reasons why, because there are, we are having, even when it comes to serial killers, we are having young serial killers are there. We are having female serial killers are there. So juvenile psychopaths are there. So first of all, they conduct the research with respect to all these perspectives. And they also develop a model how to treat them. Or we can also say how to address or how to prevent these juveniles from becoming an adult criminal or a, you know, kind of adult criminal. So these are the basic roles of a psychology of crime and delinquency. And the last one is victimology. So when it comes to victimology, we are studying about the victims. So generally what happens in most of the criminal justice system is that we try to ignore the victims. The first thing is that once a crime has happened, our ideology or our basic thought will be, okay, just give the person, that is, just give the offender the maximum punishment. But what happens to the victim or victim's family if the victim is alive or the victim survived? So what will, you know, what, how she can be psychology, how she can be rehabilitated? So the victim also should be rehabilitated if survived. So that is the basic thing when it comes to victimology. So how to rehabilitate the victims? Again, how to reintegrate the victim to the back of society as a normal person? Because when it comes to a rape victim, for example, if I am taking example of rape victim, so there will be something called as PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, or any other psychological problem for that matter, even depression, anxiety, anything, even phobia for that matter, social phobia for that matter. So the girl will be developing a lot of psychological issues. So how to rehabilitate the person, how to rehabilitate the victim? So that will be taken care of the victimology. So it's one of the emerging area under the criminology. So basically victimology also can be studied under the subdiscipline of criminology also. So these are the five main specializations of forensic psychology. So according to interest, according to a person's interest, you can choose any of this. You can become a police psychologist, or you can become a legal psychologist or correctional psychologist, or you can become a victimologist, or you can deal with the juvenile offenders. So these are the main thrust areas what we basically discuss or what we address in forensic psychology, the five main arms of the forensic psychology. And the last one is the very basic, the investigative psychology. So this is one of the new area which has been integrated to, that is, the forensic psychology. We can say right now it has been segregated, and we can say the father of investigative psychology is David Cantor. So these are the three main areas which we address in investigative psychology. So one is criminal profiling. So I hope you might have heard about criminal profiling. The people are having very little information. So, and I have seen a lot of people misinterpreting criminal profiling and psychological profiling. So criminal profiling means we are profiling an unknown person. Okay. Psychological profiling means we are profiling a known person. So when a patient, when a client walk inside to your room, if you are a clinical psychologist or a counseling psychologist, we frame, there is something called as mental status examination. We perform MSE. That is something called as psychological profiling. We can say it's one of the psychological profiling. That is totally different from criminal profiling. Criminal profiling means we are profiling an unknown person. So you might think, how it is possible for us to profile an unknown person? The first thing is that with the help of crime scene, there is something called as crime scene investigation. That is a pure forensic science. So if you are a forensic science student, you might have studied about crime scene management. So what we used to do is we integrate psychology and crime scene management, or the principles whatever we learn in crime scene management. So when you combine these, when you integrate the crime scene management concept with psychology, it becomes criminal profiling. This is how it is performed. That is something called as crime scene profiling is there. Then another one is with respect to criminal profiling is, so generally the criminal profiling is performed basically on if we are not having any clues on the criminal. For example, a crime has occurred or a series of crime has occurred and we found certain similar things in that particular each and every crimes, there is something common in that, so we can say that okay, it can be a kind of serial killing, and we can say that it can be the same offender has committed all the three crimes. So when you find that, when you address the modus operandi of that particular crime scene, it is possible for us to perform a criminal profiling. So criminal profiling is basically done in most of the cases where when we lack evidences, or when we don't have a proper cue about who has committed a crime. That is something called as criminal profiling. So criminal profiling itself is a very broad area, okay, where it is divided into inductive profiling and directive profiling. So inductive profiling is basically done by the criminologists, forensic psychologists, criminal psychologists, etc. And directive profiling is it is done by the police officers. Okay, there are a lot of there is a very vast area when you talk about. So it is 1.5 hours is not enough for me to explain on criminal profiling. Okay, so just understand criminal profiling is something different from psychological profiling. So criminal profiling means we are profiling an unknown person. Psychological profiling means we are profiling a known person. That is the basic difference. The next one is interrogation. So we are having a lot of interrogation models are there. These are the very few. Just I have put only two. One is Reed technique. Okay, developed by US. And this is the PEACE model is developed by America, that is by UK model. It's a UK model. Apart from that, we are having SCAN is there, HUMINT is there, FAINT is there. So they are having different interrogation models are there. So right now we are using the concept of micro expression. So again, I hope you might have heard about Paul Ekman. So where he explained about the non-verbal behavior and the micro expressions, where we deal with micro expressions, but we require a high speed camera for that. Okay, especially when it comes to micro expressions and when it comes to all these identifying the deception from this micro expressions, it is a very difficult thing, by because you need to have a high speed camera and we need to capture each and every emotions of the person, and then only it is possible for us to say whether the person is lying or not. That is another thing of interrogation, how to perform the interrogation. So here the scientific interrogation, as I told you, the Reed technique or PEACE model or SCAN or FAINT or even the HUMINT for that matter, we try to replace the third degree method. So this is a scientific approach given to the interrogation, how an offender can be interrogated in a scientific way. The third one is basically called as a deception. Again, so from the police psychologist, it has been transferred to investigative psychology, where the polygraph, that is basically all these are detection techniques. Basically we say about polygraph. As I told you, polygraph basically is a biofeedback. And second thing is something called as BIOS. So BIOS is brain electrical oscillation signature profiling. Brain electrical oscillation signature profiling. So it is so my professor has designed or patented this technique. His name is Dr. C.R. Mungundan. He was a professor in NIMHANS. I hope you might be knowing him. You might have heard about him. And for some people, he's a very known person. He's a well-known clinical psychologist come neuropsychologist. So he's a person who has developed BIOS. That is depending upon the brain signals. That is based upon the brain function. It's purely based upon neuropsychological principles. And third one is narcoanalysis. So narcoanalysis, basically we are using drugs. So basically it's an inverse technique. So other tools are non-inverse technique, and narcoanalysis is an inverse technique where we are injecting drugs, that is basically sodium pentothal, sodium ethyl, etc. to the bloodstream. And generally what we used to do is we try to take the information from the offender. So I am a person who is totally against narcoanalysis. because the drugs which we are using is just like sodium pentothal or sodium amytal or scopolamine or whatever. We are having a lot of different varieties of drugs are there when it comes to narco analysis, performing in narco analysis. And mostly in India, we are using sodium pentothal. So sodium pentothal is a barbiturate which affects your central nervous system. The research studies also shows that after the narco analysis, or even before, so basically there are a lot of procedures which we, a set of procedures which we go for while examining or while you performing an narco analysis. That is pre-test is there, then that is pre-test is there, post-test is there. So there are a lot of procedures that we need to follow if you are performing the narco analysis. And these drugs are having, especially these drugs also can harm the brain cells also, especially certain part of the brain, especially the prefrontal area now. So where the higher cognitive processes are associated. So it can affect especially the different areas of the brains also. So I am a person who is strongly against the narco analysis. And all these techniques, especially the polygraph, BIOS, or narco analysis for that matter, it is just taken as a corroborative evidence. Okay? So in the court of law, especially when it comes to court of law, when it comes to Indian judicial or when it comes to Indian criminal justice system, all these techniques are considered to be a corroborative evidence. It is just an aid to an investigation. It cannot be taken as a conclusive evidence. No. The conclusive evidence we are having, DNA is there, fingerprints are there. So that is something called as conclusive evidence. But when it comes to those polygraph, BIOS or narco analysis, it is just a corroborative evidence. Okay, so just an aid to an investigation. Why? Because we are having, according to Article 20, Clause 3 of Indian Constitution, it says that no person shall be a witness against himself. Something called as right against self-incrimination. And we are having something called as Article 161, Clause 2. That is right to remain silent. CRP is Section 161, Clause 2. So these are things which protect the right of an offender. So this is what we do in deception technique. Okay? And never consider this as a conclusive evidence. And some people ask about accuracy of polygraph. So the accuracy of polygraph is hardly 80 to 85%. Okay, so if you are using a good standard computerized polygraph technique, so maximum we can say 80 to 85%. That's it. And we are having different type of questioning techniques out there. That is something called as relevant, irrelevant, control question, peak of tension test. So basically, we are having a different varieties of questioning techniques are also there. And how you read the graph also is very important. So it is a very broad area. So as I told you in the beginning, forensic psychology is a very broad area. It's a very broad area where we can do a lot of research. Okay, so that's it. So if you're having any doubt, you can ask me.